I will first outline what happened in this particular agreement. The chronology of events. 1MDB and PetroSaudi obviously are two parties that have been discussing to set up a joint venture. Now on 18th of September, PetroSaudi incorporated a wholly owned subsidiary. So they set up a subsidiary first. The name is 1MDB PetroSaudi Limited. Okay? So already they know that they're going to do a joint venture. They set up the 100% owned subsidiary first, 18th of September. Now, after the setup, 1 week later, 25th of September, PSI, which is PetroSaudi, the parent, signed an agreement with the subsidiary 1MDB PetroSaudi. Okay? So they signed a loan agreement whereby the subsidiary 1MDB PetroSaudi agreed it owed the parent $700 million or approximately 2.5 billion ringgit in advances. So straight away after signing this agreement, the subsidiary owes the parent $700 million. Okay? Now, 4 days later, 29th of September, 1MDB buys the new shares in the subsidiary, paying $1 billion cash. Okay? So they want to buy 40% of the subsidiary for $1 billion cash. So if 40% is 1 billion, 60% is 1.5 billion. So PetroSaudi, the parent, must put in 1.5 billion. But they didn't put in cash, they put in assets. Okay? Now I'm not going to question the assets. Whether the assets really 1.5 billion or not, that's subject to another discussion. But on paper, 1.5 billion of assets injected by PetroSaudi, 1 billion US dollars are injected by 1MDB. So the only party that puts in cash into this joint venture is 1MDB. Now, because the subsidiary 1MDB PetroSaudi Limited already owes the parent PetroSaudi $700 million. Immediately, 30th of September, okay, $700 million is paid to the parent. Now this, on the surface of it, looks like a con job. It looks like a job to give PetroSaudi to take away 700 million. PetroSaudi or whoever he nominate to take away $700 million from 1MDB. Okay, as I've stated earlier in my earlier statement on Saturday, this agreement is clear. It's not a hidden loan. That means 1MDB is aware that the subsidiary, the empty subsidiary with nothing inside, already owes the parent 700 million. So it looks to me like a collusion. Okay, that 1MDB in PetroSaudi is working hand in hand to allow PetroSaudi or whoever it nominates to take up 700 million to do what it likes. This is the reason why the agreement becomes a big expose. Now, what happened after that? Today's statement is about what happened after that. Now, potential cover-up number one. Okay, possible cover-up number one. 6 months after joint venture agreement, 6 months later, on the 31st of March 2010. Okay, and that's exactly the financial year end. 31st of March 2010 is exactly the date whereby the audited report is supposed to complete. Okay? So by right, if the audited report is to sign off on 31st of March 2010, the JV details will come out. Okay? But what happened is on the 31st of March, ngam-ngam, okay, maybe it's a coincidence, okay, the equity, the shares in the subsidiary, 1MDB PetroSaudi, was converted from equity shares to loan. So originally, 1MDB has 40% shares in the joint venture. They decided that, to quote the word of Kanda and the chairman, Tan Sri Lok Kamarudin, said about the same thing. The plan didn't go through. The plan for the JV didn't go through. It didn't work out. Okay? So because of that, we decided not to participate in the joint venture. Okay? So what they did was, they sold the 40% shares. You want ready, Mark? I sell my shares, 40%. In fact, I sell it for a profit. I sold it for 1.2 billion because apparently in that 6 months, the value of the shares went up. Okay? So they sold it for a profit, 1.2 billion. That sounds like a good thing to me. Except, they didn't take back the money. When you sell your shares, you don't want it anymore, you don't want to participate in the joint venture because the plans didn't go through or the prospects didn't look good. Okay? You sell your shares, you take back your money. But they didn't take back the money. They sold the shares for 1.2 billion, then the 1.2 billion they lent back to 1MDB Capital Saudi, even though they have no more shares in the company. Now that to me sounds very odd. They lent it back via a 11-year bond, Islamic bond called Murabaha Notes. Why is it that you want to exit the joint venture equity where you get to participate in the profits? Okay? You don't want, but you decided that it's not going to be profitable enough or stuff like that, but you're still willing to lend the money back to the subsidiary, to that company, the amount of 1.2 billion US dollars. Now, lending is one thing. This is an empty shell subsidiary. How can it afford 1.2 billion US dollars of loans? So they got a guarantee from the corporate PSI, the Petro Saudi parent, which is also ridiculous because Petro Saudi International didn't have much. But that I'll leave it to another story. Okay, so the only only collateral they have to the 1.2 billion US dollar loan is the corporate guarantee from Petro Saudi. Now, why do I call it a potential cover-up? Okay, it's a potential cover-up because if it is shares in the joint venture agreement, the details would have been written in the audited report for 31st of March 2010. The details of that. But now because it's a loan, it's no longer equity, it's no longer shares, the audited report for March 2010 don't have to talk about the joint venture, they just need to talk about what MDB gave the loan on the back of Petro Saudi corporate guarantee. So they didn't lose any money. I lent 1.2 billion US dollars. I made a profit somehow of 200 million US dollars. Okay? And I didn't lose any money. It is up to Petro Saudi how they want to use their money. Okay? All I know is I lent them the money, I collect interest, it is over 11 years. So that's what's recorded in the audited accounts. That's number one. Now, further to the first transaction, okay, they added two more loans. So the 31st of March, they gave 1.2 billion US dollars. Later in 2010, they gave another 500 million US dollars. And in 2011, they gave another 200 million US dollars. Okay? So total, they lent to this 1MDB Petro Saudi, which they had zero shares. Okay? Is 1.9 billion US dollars. Or approximately, I use 3.5 for easy calculation, 5.7 billion. So if you want to use the current exchange rate, it's 3.6. But I use 3.5. Okay? So they basically lend more money to Petro Saudi. Now, come 19th of September 2012, okay? Could there have been a potential cover up from the group? Okay? The financial year end is actually 31st of March 2012, so September is past the financial year end. But the account's not signed yet. Don't know why. The account should have been signed by sometime in September, but not signed yet. Okay? So this deal came about whereby the Murabaha notes, basically the bonds, okay, which is 1.9 billion nominal value. Okay, because they maybe future interest they brought into the case, sold to someone unnamed. Someone just bought it for 2.318 billion. Okay, so I sold all my loans, someone else take over. for 2.318. So I got 2.318, which is a good thing. Okay? Except, again, they didn't bring back the money. Okay? They decided to park it in Cayman Islands under an investment scheme. So this was the Cayman Islands money. Okay? They park it there in an unnamed segregated portfolio company. This is, I quote from the audited accounts, managed by licensed investment manager. They didn't mention who the investment managers are. Regulated by the relevant monetary authorities. They didn't mention which monetary authorities. Okay? So it is a mysterious investment, and this issue we have talked about in our earlier press conferences last year and so on. So they have 2.3 billion parked in Cayman Islands. Okay? Don't know with who, don't know why. Okay? And the best thing about this investment in Cayman Islands that most people don't know about is even the auditors don't really know how much it's worth. Okay? The auditors classified it as a level 3 asset. There's level 1, level 2, the lowest is level 3. Level 3 asset is where the valuation of the asset, okay, is basically derived from valuation techniques that include inputs for the asset or liability that are not based on observable market data or, in brackets, unobservable inputs. So someone else provided a valuation. I don't really know whether it's valued as such or not, but based on that valuation, this is a level 3 asset. So they included this figure in the accounts, but they are not very sure if the 2.318 is really 2.318. Okay? And Caymans, you cannot check anything. The reason why people go to Caymans is because you can hide ownership, you can hide your accounts, you can hide everything in Caymans. Okay? It is also a well-known tax haven. So basically, again, we are not sure where the money is. Okay? And whether it is an attempt, essentially, to cover up the Murabaha notes, which was the original cover-up for the Petro-Saudi joint venture. So maybe the auditors, I'm speculating here, were getting worried about the Murabaha notes because a lot of money, they have to pay interest, okay, and we are not sure whether this Petro-Saudi is able to service their loan. So instead, they took the whole thing away and put it in Cayman Islands, which no one can then check. Okay? So after the transaction, the audited accounts was finally tabled on the 28th of December. The audited accounts for March 2012, correct? Okay, was tabled on 28th of December 2012. Now, we all know this year the Cayman's money has been redeemed. Okay? Board of Directors on 1st of August. Again, the accounts supposed to be completed by 31st of March 2014. Okay, 31st of March 2014. Not completed, we know it was late. It was partly because of this. Okay, 1st of August, the Board of Directors authorized redemption. Redemption means sell the investment, take back the money. Okay? So as of November 2014, in the 2014 audited accounts, it was signed off on the 5th of November 2014. Okay? 1.22 billion, or approximately half of it, has been redeemed. And in the audited accounts, it says it's used for paying debt interest, buy about options, this one and another story, working capital, and they promised that the rest of it will be by end of November. So those who follow the story will know this has already been out. So they have collected 1.22 billion, which they used to pay off everything else. Okay, we do know the exact details, but it says something like this. And the balance of it, because it's 2.318, the balance of it, they promised by end of November. So, the auditors signed off the accounts on 5th of November 2014. End of November, Cayman's not redeemed, the balance. December, Cayman's not redeemed. And after a lot of hue and cry, we issued some statements. Okay, finally, the balance of 1.1 billion was redeemed. But as you have seen from Arun's statement, the funds are not repatriated. Redeemed, that means the investment sold, but where the money is now, if there is money, we don't know. funds are not repatriated, whereabouts unknown. Even Dr. M was saying, where's the money? Tell us which bank. How much in the account? Dr. M was asking that. Okay? We don't know. And they refused to say, even until a few days ago, when Arul made a statement, I think there was an interview on Malaysia TV. Okay? But at the same time, while they don't bring back the money, we all know that on 30th November, they have another loan of 2 billion ringgit, which was due, and they couldn't pay. So it's very funny that you have about 1.1 billion US dollars, which is about 4 billion ringgit, overseas, sitting, doing nothing, you got 2 billion loan, half of that money, outstanding here, need to pay the bank. You don't just quickly take the money, pay the bank first, worry about the other stuff later. They track, extended from 30th November to 31st December. Cannot pay. Extend to 31st January. Cannot pay. You're going to default before the end of February. Only before the end of February, the loan was paid, 2 billion ringgit. But the rumored, the speculated repayment method was to borrow from Tan Sri Ananda Krishna, which Arul refused to confirm or deny. He just says, that's just speculation. But he refused to say, it's not true. Or he refused to say, it's true. Usually, if you don't want to say it's not true, it's true lah. But I don't know. He says it's speculation, he refused to confirm or deny or explain. So it's very mysterious how they paid the 2 billion ringgit loan. I'm sure if they brought back the money to pay the loan, they would have announced, this is internal funds. We have no cash flow problem, we have the money to pay the loan. But he didn't explain. Okay? So that's the background to the whole, this part of the 1MDB problem. There are other parts of 1MDB problem, but this is the part where the whole picture now seems to be coming together when we understand why all these complicated financial maneuvers. Is it to cover up what happened in the JV agreement? So I'll just go to the statement now. The Sarawak report exposed the secret 1MDB and PetroSaudi International Limited joint venture JV agreement dated 29th of September 2009, revealing details which points towards a highly elaborate scam to siphon money from 1MDB. Despite knowing that 1MDB PetroSaudi Limited had a dubious existing debt of US had a dubious existing debt of US$700 million. 1MDB agreed to invest $1 billion into the newly set up company to subscribe for 40% of new shares. Immediately after signing the agreement, 1MDB PetroSaudi repaid in full the $700 million of advances to PSI PetroSaudi International using the newly received funds from 1MDB. I had earlier asked, this was my Saturday statement, the Prime Minister, Dato' Sri Najib Razak, and 1MDB to explain why on earth did 1MDB invest $1 billion in a JV where the JV partner immediately gets to siphon 70% of the funds out of the joint venture for practically nothing in return. Now the response from the newly appointed CEO of 1MDB, Arul Kandar Kandasamy, was both disappointing and evasive. He responded yesterday, this was reported in the Malaysian Insider. Arul Kandar said that the JV was terminated 6 months later, on 31st of March 2010. The US $1 billion investment was revalued to $1.2 billion and converted into Murabaha notes, or as an Islamic loan, to the PetroSaudi subsidiary. The 1MDB CEO further argued that these Murabaha notes were paid back in full, with 1MDB earning a profit of $488 million in 2013. Now, Arul Kandar completely avoided dealing with the brazen attempt to siphon $700 million out of 1 MDB, 2 Petrosaldi, all its nominees, which in itself, even if you make that profit, that transaction itself, okay, is a blatant failure of the director's fiduciary duty and corporate governance. Why do I say that? It's like, you know, I have this company, I'm the financial controller, I'm not the shareholder, I'm the financial controller. I take out money first, later put back in. Even though I put back the money already, the act of taking out the money is wrong. It's a crime. Okay? So the act itself is wrong already. But doesn't matter. In this case, they say that it's basically I still make money. It's okay. It's not okay. But I'm questioning also the point of whether they actually made money. In fact, the exposed JV agreement and Arukanda's reply now give stronger reasons to ask if the $1 billion investment, which was suddenly converted to a loan on the very last day of March 2010 of the financial year, was in actual fact a cover-up of the JV scam. Okay, is it a cover-up? By converting it into a loan to PetroSaudi, 1MDB was then able to avoid reporting the details of the JV agreement in the 2010 financial report. So we don't know about the JV agreement until it was exposed by Sarawak report. How else could one reasonably explain why, if 1MDB decided that the JV with PetroSaudi did not work out, 1MDB didn't just withdraw its $1.2 billion investment, US dollar investment in full. Instead, the funds which were raised by a debt guaranteed by the Malaysian federal government was inexplicably extended as a loan to the PetroSaudi subsidiary. If 1MDB did not believe in the business model anymore, then why did it still lend money to the venture? In fact, 1MDB twice further extended loans via Murabahan notes to the PetroSaudi subsidiary. 500 million later in 2010 and another $200 million in 2011. Hence, the total loan extended under the OPIC scheme was $1.9 billion. It should be highlighted here, a side point, that 1MDB was never set up with any objective or any objective remotely close to become a money lending company. Why did it lend the money when it is not supposed to? It's not set up to lend money. It's not set up to borrow money and use that borrow money to lend someone else money. That's worse. But again, that's the question that 1MDB needs to answer. Then in September 2012, before its March 2012 accounts was signed off, the Murabahan notes were sold to an undisclosed party for $2.318 billion, giving 1MDB a profit of $418 million. The whole dubious episode would have ended there if the proceeds of the sale were returned to the company. Unfortunately, the ministry deepened when the proceeds were controversially invested in a segregated portfolio company in Cayman Islands, which was managed by licensed investment manager and regulated by relevant monetary authorities. Basically, couched in very ambiguous language that's supposed to lend credibility to the investment. Again, no one, not even the auditors, KPMG in 2012, Deloitte Malaysia in 2013 and 2014, were able to verify firsthand that the monies were actually in Cayman Islands. The investment was classified as a level 3 asset where the valuation was derived from the valuation techniques that include inputs for the asset or liability that are not based on observable market data or, in brackets, unobservable inputs. Hence, once again, the restructuring of the Murabahan notes into Cayman Islands investment raises the question if this was a last-minute transaction to cover up the original cover-up to avoid further scrutiny in the financial report for March 2012. Finally, the controversial funds in the Cayman investments were fully redeemed after much public criticism on the 13th of January 2015. However, since then, Arulkanda has refused to disclose the whereabouts of the 1.1 billion balance proceeds from the redemption, only announcing that the funds will not be repatriated into Malaysia. The action not to repatriate was mind-boggling because 1MDB was frantically seeking funds to repay a 2 billion ringgit loan which was outstanding since November 2014. The 1MDB CEO also refused to confirm or deny the widely reported speculation that the 2 billion ringgit loan was finally repaid on 13th of February 2015, only with a last-minute desperate loan deal with the local billionaire Tan Sri Anandakrishnan. The whole complex and mind-boggling financial maneuvers all point towards the perpetuation and massive cover-up of a multi-billion ringgit fraud. Arulkanda proudly announced that 1MDB made 488 million profit from the PetroSaudi transaction. But what we have at hand is at least 1.1 billion US dollars, at least, missing in unknown whereabouts. The next question to ask is hence, where exactly is this 488 million US dollars of paper profit Arul was talking about?